welcome back. Halfway through the program, I'm going to reintroduce our guests. First, we have with us Michael Taube, former speechwriter in the Prime Minister's office. We have Ron CSILLLAG, who is a freelance journalist, and Jeffrey Manishen, a lawyer with Ross McBride LLP. Okay. And picking up where we left off, this whole notion of citizen journalism, we have an article here about citizen journalism and the erosion of meaningful press credentials. The watering down of press credentials, especially as it relates to the G20 coverage, when a bunch of, I guess it's presumably young people, showed up and said, I'm a journalist. Yes, I'm a journalist, and I'm Spartacus, and I'm Spartacus. And then they had a problem on their hands as to who really was. And then the legacy media, the traditional media, takes offense to this. My question to you, and I'll start with you this time.
Sure.
Are the legacy media being dog in the manger, or is there really something more to the discussion around journalistic credentials?
Well, what is basically happening, we were sort of doing this when the TV was off, is that a lot of bloggers now have started to trump journalists on certain stories. In other words, they're capturing certain sources that the that the old mainstream journalists would have had naturally in their back pocket, but now the bloggers are starting to go after them. It doesn't necessarily mean they're as talented. It doesn't necessarily mean they're going to reach the same conclusions, and it doesn't necessarily mean the final product is going to be as good. But bloggers, especially now in party conventions like the Liberals and the Conservatives and even the NDP apparently, are going to all have bloggers sitting right up there reporting on all the action.
So they're eyewitnesses. They're not necessarily good analysts of what they've seen.
But the problem is, as Ron said, 52% of them now think they are journalists, okay. And that's the real issue. They're not.
I'd look at, and I defer to Ron on this, the idea of press credentials having some meaningful component. Mm-hmm. I think of it from the standpoint that the press credentials have to be issued to be able to get you access to some particular space that the public would not normally get. Right. And again, you come back to, well, if everybody gets them, then nobody gets them. There has to be some threshold level of responsibility where the credentials can be issued to permit the access. Otherwise, it's meaningless. Where it got to be significant in the G20, of course, was those with press credentials were being treated to some extent like others, and they felt they were even discriminated against by virtue of their credentials, so they were hiding them. But I think there is a place for press credentials and a threshold or standard you have to keep in place.
Right. Well, to pick up on what you said, how could you tell a journalist from a non-journalist at the G20 riots? The real journalists hid their press credentials. And it's true. They did, because they didn't want to be identified with the corporate MSM, the hated mainstream media. Right. There were CBC and CTV trucks that were attacked as a result of their affiliation with the globalized world. Yeah. On the other hand, there was this clown whose name I can't remember who presented himself, it's a big press pass, as a columnist for The Guardian. Guardian is one of the most respected newspapers in the world, very high editorial standards. Turned out he was no such thing. He posts on a blog that The Guardian opens up to almost anybody and everybody. And now he's gotten himself into some trouble. Now it's come out that, of course, he has no affiliation with The Guardian. The Guardian has cut him loose. You know, he cheapens the whole profession.
We don't have the offense of impersonating a journalist. Impersonate a police officer, we do.
Here's what I want to add. A couple things I thought about. There is a fundamental shift taking place in the definition of news gathering. But one of the critical factors with the mainstream legacy media is fact-checking, where you can determine what's real from what's fake, where conspiracy theories get weeded out from what's genuine. And what I coined this term in preparing for this show, that it's like vigilante journalism is what you got. We didn't like what the mainstream was doing, so we're going to do our own thing, but it's not necessarily a good thing. Some of it may be, but not in this case. We'll come back to that story in a second. Sure. Interesting, speaking of new media and its impact, Harrisburg University in Pennsylvania decided in the past week that they were going to tell other students, we're shutting down all the social media for a week. Nobody's going to use social media, and let's see what happens with that action. Now, interestingly enough, a number of journalists, including our own here, attempted to figure out what did that mean? What's the outcome? What was the upshot of not doing media for the week? And we couldn't get a straight answer out of them. We had to go to their website, surf around their website, invest time with them, give them our name, give them our email address. And we were beginning to wonder whether this whole experiment was nothing more than a bait and switch to get our names.
I would tend to think it was this, like the old lead-in to the Lone Ranger. Return with us now to those thrilling days of yesteryear when there was not the social media and people had to interact face-to-face.
Right.
And what's that going to be like? Young people today grow up with the social media built in. There's a diminished expectation of privacy. So what happens when they have to interact directly? And we're going to have an educational environment where we want to put that in place. We want to see what happens. Get rid of all the things that might distract. Let's see how it turns out. I'd be interested, Richard, in finding out how it did turn out.
If they can give us some straightforward results.
We'll have to go to their website.
Yeah, well, exactly. Well, I agree with Jeffrey on that. I think that's actually a very good point. I think also you have to start accepting reality. I'll play devil's advocate. You can't really eliminate. As terrible as it is to watch a 15-year-old sit there and text, whatever she's messaging, you know, hilarious messages with LOL and all the other nonsense that they put in there. I think we have to accept the fact that it's reality. It's now part of the mainstream. This is what people do. It doesn't mean that they're all going to become socially withdrawn, they're not going to be able to communicate, and everything's going to be ruined for the rest of their lives. It's now an aspect of life, period.
Yeah, all I could say is there were dire warnings issued when radios came out. There were dire warnings issued that television was going to spell the end of civilization as we knew it.
Okay.
I think we're at the cusp of a whole other age now.
Well, you know, it's interesting. We'll move on to this story. The Pope visited the UK. Big visit. And this is a story from the Globe and Mail, Friday, September 17th. War of words erupts in Britain on Pope's visit. I didn't really see it as a war of words. What they had done here, which only a newspaper could do, you can't really do this in you can do it in radio, but you can't do it in television properly. What the Queen said or what the Pope said, what it meant and its implications. It's like a full-scale breakout, and I'll turn this over, of the diplomacy. Who said what and what it meant. And I'll ask you, Jeffrey, why did this particular aspect of the papal UK visit receive such little notice in mainstream media? Because it didn't get much notice.
Well, in terms of saying why it didn't, I think probably it's the central point of the visit being in the UK that it gave people an opportunity to express their concern over the sexual abuse of people by the clergy over the course of a period of time. Here's the lightning rod opportunity. We may well in North America have read and heard so much about it that it may well not be quite as dramatic or dynamic as it is there.
Okay.
There's their opportunity to make it a focal point. And there's an issue for the Pope to have to address, and the way in which the articles indicated it was to focus on the rising concern about atheism.
Yeah, well, in fact, in bold in the article, I bolded it was, but beneath the surface was a war of words backed with the sort of artillery power rarely seen since the Reformation. Is that purple prose, or is that really what you saw?
Well, first of all, I disagree that it received so little media coverage. I was struck by how much media coverage received here in Canada, papal visit to England. I sort of wondered why the Pope went to England. I mean, church attendance is through the floor. I don't think his visit is going to raise it too much. Maybe there was a bounce. The Anglican Church isn't doing much better. The Queen delivered a very subtly worded little jibe to the Pope, and she has a way of doing that. I think it was pretty much ado about nothing.
Okay.
Pope Benedict was the second pope to have visited Britain following John Paul II, my guess is that partially, one, he wanted to follow in the footsteps of a very popular past pope and to make inroads into Britain. And number two, I don't think it's wrong to go into a country where Catholicism is actually going down in popularity. If there's going to be any way for it to have a bit of a euphoria and to actually have a rise in maybe interest, even if it just lasts for a few weeks, a few months, that's the way you do it. You have your pontiff go to the country, speak in front of the country, meet world leaders, meet the Queen, and look like, a very sharp, intelligent, and apt individual.
He wanted to address the sexual abuse issue firsthand, but one of the stories I found interesting that came up during the papal visit was this rumored plot to get the Pope. And when I heard that it was six street cleaners that were actually supposed to be going after the Pope, my first thought was, oh boy, we got UDA types, the ultra defense types. And then I started to look into the story, and all of them happened to be Muslims. They became referred to as the Muslim street cleaners, which I thought was the name of the band. In most of the reporting about this so-called plot, the media avoided the word Muslim, with the noted exception of one story we gave you, and we gave you an update. You read the update?
Sure, and in fact, the idea of using the M word in the course of an article, I have been surprised to hear about stories that indicate that there's been that conscious effort to be able to remove the word. What struck me, Richard, in relation to the story, was so you have an incident where six, I think they were Algerians, and they were street cleaners, and they had talked about what might happen if the Pope was to come and visit, and it got blown up into a plot to blow up. And then after further examination research, it's nothing more than conversation. What struck me was the high level of attention. You want to talk much ado about nothing. Mm-hmm. The significant media, the extremist and alarmist views, that struck me from the stories. But the second part of it, the idea of leaving the word Muslim out, how critical is that? How much is that embedded in the world of journalism today?
It's very difficult to avoid, especially when they're all Muslim. When the actuality is true, if they were all Anglican, would we have reported it? Probably not.
If they're all right-handed,
if they all wore glasses, it's not relevant. But the fact that they're all Muslim, this is like catnip to the media, especially now, especially in Britain, still recovering from 7/7.
17.
And it's just, you can't lay off it. Especially